Hey, Misabis, it's Tony D'Angelo. It is the October 26th, 2023 edition of 30 with Tony out of Domini in the year of our Lord. So happy to have you. So grateful to each and every one of you who have been following this broadcast. We air, as you know, on Thursday afternoons, 3 p.m. Eastern Time. We are on YouTube and we are on X, what I still like to call Twitter. It's the only place we need to be. If people want to come, they can come and watch us here. If they want to ignore us, they can ignore us. But many people are watching and many people are liking what they see. Many people don't like what they see. You know something? I appreciate you too, because I'm causing you to think. I'm causing you to make a defense for what it is you believe. I haven't heard a lot of really good defenses, but I'm causing you to do it. And I'm grateful for that. I'm also grateful for our music contributors who have allowed us to use their music. I think the music is fun. I get a lot of compliments on the music. And I love goofing around with songs. I mean, my dilemma in life ever since I was a kid in Ripawam High School did I want to go into accounting and law or did I want to go in radio? I still have that dilemma. It'll never be solved. So anyway, you have me here, and I'm more than grateful to have you. Our subject today is called Make It Where, or Make It Where. You could put a question mark on that. And I've been following with particular interest this thing happening with our governor, King Ned Lamont, the unaccountable, where a new marketing campaign is going to save us all. Now, mind you, there was a marketing campaign about 10 years ago called Still Revolutionary. I believe there was about $28 million spent on that. And the net result of that was the only thing that was still revolutionary was the equivalent of the Battle of Paoli during the Revolutionary War, which was a bloody massacre. You could have taken the $28 million and either done something with it or thrown it in the street to get the same effect. But that all being as it is, our state has some, shall I say, fixed beliefs that are the same beliefs that everybody's had since time immemorial that don't change anything. They get repackaged, they get restated, they get re-this to re-that, but we always seem to end up in the same place. So we're going to take a look at that today. And this is kind of a complex subject, so I've got a number of shares. If you can bear with me for a second, if I don't mess this up. And here we go. I'm going to go over here to my first share. This is an article by a young lady, Erica L. Phillips, in the CT Mirror called Make It Here Joins Find Your Vibe in the Latest CT Marketing Blitz. Marketing blitz. I'm going to hold on to that thought just for a moment, but I'm praying. I don't want to start cursing just yet. Here's a picture of our governor on the right. Gov, that gray hair does not really do wonders for you. Kind of makes you look not so hot, personally, but I think you did better when you colored your hair. But here's a gentleman who is speaking. I believe he is the marketing director for the state of Connecticut. But state officials have rolled out a new logo and slogan for Connecticut in an effort to overcome negative perceptions and appeal to a younger demographic. Governor Ned Lamont, along with other state dignitaries, Softball spit. And small business leaders presented the state's new brand campaign, Make It Here. And this is a new logo and everything. The governor points to a survey that says people aren't looking at Connecticut as a positive place to be. No stuff, Sherlock. Now they're trying a number of different things, and there's a new thing about, you know, well, we've got a lot of things we're doing here. You know, we've got great pizza, we've got manufacturing, and here's the state did spend $27 million on Still Revolutionary. If Still Revolutionary was really revolutionary, we wouldn't have to be starting another revolution, right? So here's your logo. I kind of looks like a Toosie toy to me. But with that being as it is, the survey that was conducted said that 21% of residents say they were likely to recommend Connecticut, and we're going to save that with a marketing campaign. On and on and on and on we go. So now we're going to be spending more money, and we're going to be having our senses assaulted with the whole thing of Make It Here in Connecticut. And maybe this is where I need to say what I was going to say. There's an old saying in the financial services industry called lipstick on a pig. And if you take lipstick and you put lipstick on a pig, the still have a pig. You have a pretty pig. Maybe you put a bow on the pig, but it's still a pig. And Connecticut over here wants to rebrand itself with something really jazzy, but yet does not want to deal with any of its inherent problems. We're just going to keep growing the state budget. We're just going to keep hiring and fueling in agencies like our incompetent and should be abolished Department of Economic and Community Development. You know, not one politician, you know, Democrat, Republican, Martian, German, ever says, you know, we've either got to abolish this department or we've got to do something different. They just keep throwing money on it and throwing money after it. And when you do this, I mean, here we are once again in the gutter, so much so that we've got to do Make It Here. What am I missing? Please tell me what I'm missing. And I mean, I have seen Republicans, shame on you all, trumpeting the DECD as something good. Where's your mind? Where's your brain? What are you, I mean, you're Republicans, right? You're supposed to be about lower taxes and removing bureaucracies and trying to find the best way to go from point A to point B, right? You're doing the same thing they do. I mean, basically what you're doing is you're giving us a little different flavor on the sundae or a little topping, but it's still the damn sundae. But anyway, instead of me going off right now, let me give you a little bit more meat to this matter. When you see something like this, and then you run into something like this, you don't know whether to laugh, cry, scream, barf, or throw up. A marketing campaign is not going to fix Connecticut. Fixing the stupid tax policy may be able to fix Connecticut. But I don't know if even that would work now. But nonetheless, it's the only thing that perhaps can work. You want to entice, this is how stupid this state can be. You want to entice people to come to the state, right? You know, it's a good thing. Come to the state. Yeah, right. Come to Connecticut, right? You know, we have great pizza. You know, go to New Haven. Make sure you got eyes in the back of your head. But then you see this stuff. Here we have him, Martin Looney Tunes Looney, who thinks a tax can solve anything. This guy has been throwing taxes at us ever since Grant took Richmond. And now he's saying, well, the wealthy have to pay more. Okay, I am a wealthy person and I'm in another place. And, you know, I'm kind of curious about Connecticut. And I see this lummox saying he wants to tax me more. Well, why am I going to come to Connecticut? Now, maybe the DECD, you know, inept mess that it is, can write me a big enough bribe and, you know, I can just take my bribe and go. I don't know. I mean, basically, I'd kind of doubt the wisdom of that. But this guy's saying here is the wealthy need to pay more taxes. Now, we've got, I don't know, 300 some odd different taxes, and our tax system is incoherent. Do you get that? Incoherent. There's all kinds of taxes all over the place. What's wrong with a basic 3% and streamlining the bureaucracy and then rebranding on that? The new Connecticut, bold. We're not what we used to be. We're turning a corner. No, you're going to give me this junk and this nonsense. You know, we're going to go ahead and we're going to make it here. Make what here? Debt, taxes, crime? I mean, it's absolutely unbelievable. Now, when you read these articles, this gentleman that wrote the article, Keith M. Faniff, did a good job on the article, reported it accurately. But it's the same clowns talking about the same thing. The Connecticut Voices for Children, you know, the think tank, all these people who never worked a profit-making day in their lives saying that it's social justice to pay more taxes. And I, you know, you get the same thing over and over. Higher taxes will save us all, right? Look at the property taxes in New Haven and Bridgeport and Hartford. Really did a good job of saving us, right? It's absolutely insane. This state will never turn the corner. I don't care how many make it here's and all this other crap that you do. Until you get rid of somebody like Looney, until you change this tax policy. No business person of any brain will take you seriously. Sorry about that. It's the truth. And I would be remiss if I didn't tell you the truth. Now, we had a, shall I say, a well-publicized incident over the past, actually it was last week, about the Service Employees International Union in Connecticut and its then head, Cooper Caraway, who basically is a hired gun coming in from Texas or coming in from South Dakota. And what our Republican Party on a national and local basis is too stupid, inept, or inane to realize. Listen, I'm telling you where it's at today. I really don't care. The gloves are off. Look at the world that we're living in. What they don't realize is the liberal demo commies, as the Colonel Simmons says, Colonel Rob Simmons, when he comes on the Lee Elsie show, have a depth chart and a bench. They pluck from various areas in the country and they slot people in to where they think they could do the most damage. These are not local operatives. These are not people who are homegrown. These are franchise people. It's like the first time you go to some restaurant, you know, years back, I used to go to the Brugger's Bagels in New Haven, you know, really good bagels. And I thought, gee, that's a really nice, unique little local brand. Until I started to see it somewhere else. I said, gee, yeah, it's a franchise. Well, the Demo Commies franchise, the Demo Commies play the statistics and play the computer game a whole lot better than the Republicans who are playing it like it's 1995. So this Cooper Caraway was a hired gun. He came in to do damage, and oh boy, did he do damage. He pretty much walked to the steps of the New Haven City Hall, where I think the first time in history a protest at the New Haven City Hall was something with a little bit of life at it. It's usually the same 15 or 20 dour women who don't say a word holding up signs. And when you ask them a question, they point you to Henry Lowendorf, at least years back, who did. And, you know, Henry didn't tell you that much either, other than railing about imperialism and all the things that were wrong in America. And it's like, this really isn't a protest. What are you doing out here? But this guy was throwing some juice. I disagree with every single wretched thing he said, but he was throwing some juice. Now, because of the fact that he was so rotten and so communist and so ugly, people paid attention to it. And it caused, actually, it did a couple of things. It caused me to think, well, if this is our local state employee union, which of course is a creature of habit, is a creature of legislature. This all didn't happen overnight. This guy was there. And the fact that our political parties, who of course pander to this union because they need the votes and they need the favor, they had to know the guy was there. They had to know what the guy was like. And he unleashes himself on the world with the Israel-Hamas war. And finally, we see something from our local Republican Party saying, you know, powers that be, you got to get rid of this guy. Letter October 17, 2023. Make sure I got the players right. The people writing the letter, State Representative Devin Carney, Mitch Belinsky, Vincent Candelora, and Kevin Kelly, the House Republican leader, the Senate Republican leader, the Assistant Republican leaders, both the Messrs. Carney and Belinsky. Now, when you read the letter, it is, I like to call letters like this prayers of petition. And in this prayer of petition, the Republican politicians are going to this group, the usual suspects in the Democrat Party, Lamont, Duff, Rojas, Ritter, and Looney, saying, same Looney, you got to get rid of this guy because he's bad for business. And it's like, well, I hate to tell you something, people, but this guy is not a cause of anything. He rather is a symptom of what is all things Connecticut. Now, go back to Make It Here, right? Find Your Vibe and all this other kind of stuff. Go back to Martin Looney wanting to take you and tax your eyeballs out. And you're a CEO and you see the Cooper Caraway nonsense and you're really going to want to come here. And it's just to the Republicans' credit. I mean, you know, I call this letter a base on balls. They finally reached base. Maybe they reached base in the eighth inning, nine runs down, but they reached base. Now, that should not be discounted. But there's one line in this letter that drove me absolutely through a wall. The collective Republicans say to the collective Democrats, Mr. Caraway has cast a dark shadow over the state of Connecticut as it works to grow its economy, an effort that requires a deep and positive partnership with the private sector. What game are you guys watching? A deep and positive partnership with the private sector. A deep and positive partnership with the private sector is a 3% tax rate, is torching a bureaucracy, is folding up the Department of Economic and Community Development, is stopping this baloney of winners and losers. That's a deep and positive partnership of having a Department of Revenue Services where there is a people's court where you can deal with some of the rotten auditors and appeals officers I've had through the years, a lot of whom are ex-cops who wouldn't know the tax law from a Ford Fairlane. I mean, if that's what you were going to do, that's what you would do. But of course, you don't do that. You know, you're trying to play nice in the sandbox. A deep and positive partnership. I'm not meaning to jump on you as that, in as much as I see Make It Here, as much as I say this bird brain wants to tax us all to death. Just absolutely drive me through the wall. So we have in this state, if you're watching this from out of state, we have basically one political party. It is the Democrat Party that kind of fashions itself into the uniparty. I really don't want to look at Mr. Looney, so I'll go back over to Make It Here. And we don't have, we've never had really advocating conservative, fiscally conservative Republicans. And we've suffered because of it. Because when the populace, SAT word, when the people are insulted and maligned by people in government, there should be a other than me, other than a George Colley or a Bob Swick or somebody on Twitter who would like to have his name and his face out there, but is concerned about, you know, having his home torch or something like that in this, you know, zero safe state. The other than people like that, we do not have advocating opposite clear thinking political figures on the other side of this kind of bonkers lunacy. Somebody like Mr. Looney does not realize or does not care to realize. He thinks that, you know, the Connecticut administrative state is going to save us all. But when you look at that, and when you look at that kind of thing, why can't the private sector save itself if the government stayed the hell out of the way? And, you know, please, if you will, I really would appreciate it if you would stop telling me about the deep and positive, shall we say, partnership with the private sector. Now, I'm just going to go over to here for a moment, and I'm going to just having a little bit of a thing with the share. And let me just go over to here. And I love this program, but it doesn't always do exactly what I want it to do. A deep and positive partnership. Well, a deep and positive partnership is advocating for the little guy, the taxpayer, the person that perhaps does see the good in Connecticut and wants to use that good to grow his family and to grow his business. You know, the administrative state is not going to do any of that. So don't let me read that and not comment on it. But since we have these power mad lunatics, this is an interesting development. This is my friend and colleague, George Colley, who posted this, I believe it was last Friday. And there is a post here. This post here was taken down by the Connecticut Senate Democrats. And George says it perfectly. A day after their SEIU terrorist praising commie rat gets run out of town, these divisive, nasty, repugnant tweets always come out on Fridays because it's day drinking in the state Senate socialists. I'd love to know if the author of this crap is doing this on the public's dime during the workday. I don't even, the fact that they took the tweet down, that is so typically what they do. They make statements and they do this and they continually do this. And you know something? They're going to continue to do this. But where are the other people in the administrative state and in the Republican Party to say, you know, stop this. Stop this nonsense. Stop this crap. Stop complaining about people who don't agree with you. Stop disrespecting them. You know, you are a farce to continue to do this. And, you know, where do we have the legislator against the legislator? Not for the sake of violence, but for the sake of the advocacy of the people. I don't see it. I don't see it. You're going to tell me here about the, I'm not going to go back to it, the deep and enduring partnership. I mean, it's like this dawned on me, you know, it's the same thing over and over and over and over. And we get to the same place and nothing really ever changes. And I'm going to show that to you here in just a moment. Remember this, the same crap. Now this was Joe Arisimowitz, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, Joe Arisimowitz, held a high place in the Connecticut legislature. And long about 2020, Joe Arisimowitz made a speech, shall we say, on Twitter, about people protesting the Save Connecticut rally. Now read this. All the people at the Save Connecticut rally today at the Capitol should stand really close together, don't wear masks, maybe even drink from the same water bottles. I'll see y'all in 21 days after you get sick and remain quarantined for the Let's Make Responsible Decisions rally. I'll hold your signs because you'll still be weak. They usually teach us in elementary school not to make emotional decisions. So this idiot went and insulted an entire group of people. He later made an apology. That's not really relevant. You know, maybe he repented, maybe he didn't repent. My point is, where is a Republican taking this guy out behind the woodshed and saying, how dare you do this? How dare you insult the people of Connecticut that don't agree with you? Same thing over here. Same thing over here with George's tweet. You know, they do this and they continually do this, but yet they want to tell us about the enduring partnership and then they want to give us new marketing. It's like, you know, stop the nonsense. And I keep saying that. So when you go over to here, make it here, find your still revolutionary, seagulls are beautiful, whatever it is. This is taking your money. This is throwing it in the street until you deal with what's fundamentally wrong in the state. And if you're not going to deal with what's fundamentally wrong, I'm going to stop this year. If you're not going to deal with what's fundamentally wrong, I don't have any time for you. I don't have any interest in you. You are just sitting there, you know, throwing money, asking me for campaign contributions, and you're going to go out and do the same freaking crap that you've done for 20, 25, 30 years, and you're going to tell me it's going to be different. Well, guess what? It isn't. And I just showed you that it isn't different. So tired of it. It's absolutely positively insane. We need new people. We need new government. We need new perspectives. Now, new perspectives are not perspectives that necessarily agree with me, but people who want to represent their particular view of the world and work to a common solution to literally save the state from these idiots that we've seen that have been running it. It's simple as that and just as difficult. And I am just so tired of it. And it's really, in my humble estimation, this needs to be changed. It's Tony D'Angelo here on 30 with Tony. We are rocking it out, baby. We'll be right back in 60 seconds.
Attention, minions. This is Zena, CFO and Administrative Manager of LoveBot Connect, the first and only robotic dating service in King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable's Connecticut. On last week's 30 with Tony, we discussed our exciting new business model with real men and real women, two of the 83 approved Connecticut genders. Can build your ideal partner and date with no cash outlay. Think of it. Stimulating conversation. Faithfulness. Unlimited intelligence. And no gender identity issues. However, what happened this week could not have been imagined by us even in our darkest moments. As discussed, we only deal with real men and women. But much to our surprise, we were besieged with calls and messages from the other 81 genders. While flattered, we must regrettably say that we do not support genders other than real men and real women. Frankly, our programming is not equipped to handle genders such as Cat, Moon Island Chameleon, and Purple Paranoid Passionate Passenger Pigeon. The last gender was just added in 2023 via a unanimous act of the Connecticut State Legislature, followed by the unaccountable signing the bill in his old moth-eaten Big Bird Halloween costume. So if you are a real man or real woman desiring a reliable and riveting robotic pal, call us at 1-800-UR-BOTS for more information. Again, since we are completely robotic bordering on the virtual, the kingdom of his royal conman Ned Lamont has not figured out how to tax yet. So get here now while prices are low. Of course, if you wait, prices will increase, as we then must move to the Cayman Islands in order to operate. And now, back to our program of 30 with Tony.
We'll be right back.
Well, thanks, Kemosabes. Thanks for staying with us. And it's unusual to come back to a screen share, but I believe this bears some mention and some repeating. Article in the Connecticut Examiner, October 7, 2023, written by Angela Carella, about the Italian-American heritage in Stanford, celebrating history and stories. And it's a really good article if you read it. And it talks about the people of Stanford, Connecticut, the Italians that came to town. They came as second-class citizens, but they worked and they built things. And the town accepted them, and they continue to go forward, and they continue to do great things. People, famous people came from the Italians of Stanford, Connecticut. Michael Dante, my friend, pal, and mentor, great actor, 150 television shows, 30 feature films, probably about 20 appearances on Monday Night Sports Talk and Tony D'Angelo's PM Coast to Coast, but God bless him. Andy Robustelli, Hall of Fame football player, football coach, Mr. Robustelli to us peons. Bobby Valentine needs no mention. We all know who Bobby Valentine is and what he's done in his life. And, you know, I am a proud Italian-American from Stanford, Connecticut, and a large part of who I am is because of Stanford, Connecticut. Not that everything that happened in Stanford, Connecticut was perfect. Not that I did everything perfectly, but I wouldn't be here but for these people, and I am so grateful today. So it is important to call attention to good things. This is a good thing. People are working to tell us about what the Italians did in Stanford, Connecticut. Today, I'm damn proud to be one of them. But that said, I'd like to share with you a little story. You know, you think of the Italians in Stanford, Connecticut, and you think of people who have come to this country to do great things and have done great things. But a lot of people have become disgusted with the United States of America, rightfully so. I mean, it's an absolute positive, insane mess today. I could spend 3 hours talking about it. But I heard of a couple of fellas that had enough and went down to Mexico to start a bungee jumping business. You know, they just kind of packed up the truck and left. So they started, you know, they did whatever they needed to do with the Mexican authorities, and they started their actual first bungee jumps. So the first guy gets on his bungee and jumps off of a bridge, but the bungee is too long, and he hits the ground with a splat, and he's bruised, and he's battered, and his glasses are broken, and his friend pulls him up on the crane and says, "What happened?" He says, "Oh, I think the bungee was too long." You know, trial and error, kind of a painful thing that should place. So the second guy says, "Well, let me try it. I'm going to shorten the bungee." Okay, great, good idea. So the second guy goes over and he's hanging perfectly where he needs to be, about 3 feet, 4 feet off the ground, you know, depending on which way he swung. So a bunch of Mexican people come over and they start beating him with broomsticks. And he's like, stop, wait. And, you know, his friend pulls him up on the reel and says, "Well, what happened?" He says, "I don't know. I'm not going to like this place any more than I liked America. Look at what these people did to me." And the guy cleans himself off and he wipes the towels. He's putting alcohol on his bruises. And he goes to his friend and says, "Tell me something. What the hell is a piñata?" It's Tony D'Angelo here at 30 with Tony. I'm so grateful to have you here today. We'll be back next week with more stuff. Love you guys. Thank you for being with us at every single step of the way. And moreover, God bless you and God help us all. Bye now. Talk about my baby. Little apple blue. There ain't no that she couldn't do. She's my groovy little baby, yeah. A little Latin loop-a-loop. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba loop-a-loop. I take a loop-a-loop. Why is a pretty baby? Hello.
Loop-a-loop-a-loop.